There we go.
Good morning and welcome, everyone. It's good to see everyone today. Welcome to our spiritual home, the Unitarian Universalist Church of Tarpon Springs. Our church is located here in the heart of the walkable Tarpon Springs Historic District and is known as the home of the Innes paintings. My name is Barbara Rosen, and I serve on our Board of Trustees, Worship Committee, and I'm serving as your Worship Associate today. We are a church of many welcomes, and we offer a warm welcome to all of you who have joined us in person and on Zoom. This is a liberal community for all ages, promoting spiritual growth, social justice, and the arts. As such, ours is an active church, and everyone is invited to participate in any of our activities, whether you are a member or not. To learn more about events, our church calendar is on the website, uutarpon.org, or you can discuss activities with church members or our membership chair if we have your information. Although our children are not with us during the service at this time, we do have faith formation programming available with our gifted leader, Jami, Cruz. Children are gathering for their time together with her and a member of the congregation and meeting just outside the social hall. If you'd like more information about our programming, please contact Reverend Kristina or see Jami after the service. For those present with us in the building, we have connection cards available in the pews near the hymnals. If you fill one out and put it in the offering plate or give it to one of our greeters, we will be able to keep in touch with you. We are delighted to have Reverend Kristina Spaude leading the service today with the title, Mayday, Mayday. May 1st is celebrated as International Workers' Day. The U.S. has seen a resurgence of interest in labor unions, and we'll explore their history and future through the lens of our UU values in this service. Music is provided by our music director, Bonnie Whitehurst, and today, our soloist for the day, Ann Rhody. They will be singing throughout the service. You are welcome to sing along to the hymns wearing masks. Again, welcome. And we begin our service with this with a chalice lighting with these words from Florence Kaplow. In recognition of May Day, we light this flame to honor all work, including the work of our hands and our backs, in gratitude for all the labors that support our world, and for all those who boldly continue the work of justice, equity, and peace.
Now I walk in beauty, beauty is before me, beauty is behind me, above and below me.
Now I walk in beauty,
now I walk in beauty, beauty is before me, beauty is behind me, above and below me. Now I walk in beauty, beauty
Our story today is from Doreen Cronin, and this is Click, Clack, Moo, Cows That Type. Farmer Brown has a problem. His cows like to type. All day long he hears click, clack, moo, click, clack, moo, clickety, clack, moo. At first he couldn't believe his ears. Cows that type? Impossible. Click, clack, moo. Click, clack, moo. Clickety, clack, moo. Then he couldn't believe his eyes. A letter nailed to the barn door read, Dear Farmer Brown, the barn is very cold at night. We'd like some electric blankets. Sincerely, the cows. It was bad enough that the cows had found the old typewriter in the barn. Now they wanted electric blankets. No way, said Farmer Brown. No electric blankets. So the cows went on strike. They left a note on the barn door. Sorry, we're closed. No milk today. No milk today, cried Farmer Brown. In the background, he heard the cows busy at work. Click, clack, moo. Click, clack, moo. Clickety, clack, moo. The next day, he got another note. Dear Farmer Brown, the hens are cold too. They'd like electric blankets. Sincerely, the cows. The cows were growing impatient with the farmer. They left a new note on the barn door. No eggs, cried Farmer Brown. In the background, he heard them. Click, clack, moo. Click, clack, moo. Clickety, clack, moo. Cows that type, hens that strike, whoever heard such a thing? How can I run a farm with no milk and no eggs? Farmer Brown was furious. Farmer Brown got out his own typewriter. Dear cows and hens, there will be no electric blankets. You are cows and hens. I demand milk and eggs. Sincerely, Farmer Brown. Duck was a neutral party, so he brought the ultimatum to the cows. The cows held an emergency meeting. All the animals gathered around the barn to snoop, but none of them could understand moo. All night long, Farmer Brown waited for an answer. Duck knocked on the door early the next morning. He handed Farmer Brown a note. Dear Farmer Brown, we will exchange our typewriter for electric blankets. Leave them outside the barn door and we will send Duck over with the typewriter. Sincerely, the cows. Farmer Brown decided this was a good deal. He left the blankets next to the barn door and waited for Duck to come with the typewriter. The next morning, he got a note. Dear Farmer Brown, the pond is quite boring. We'd like a diving board. Sincerely, the ducks. Click, clack, quack. Click, clack, quack. Clickety, clack, quack.
We can give up bitter and shattered, or we can slowly start to build a beautiful city. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. We can build a beautiful city, not a city of angels, but finally a city of men. A city of men. Ooh. A city of
Now is the time in the service where we take our offering for the work and welfare of this church. Ours is a free faith which must sustain itself financially. This month, a social justice council is asking for donations for May's Give the Plate. The recipient is Minister's Discretionary Fund. This fund exists as a way to support people with short-term immediate needs. People who benefit from this fund may be congregants or in the wider community. With a significant housing shortage in the Tampa Bay area, most of the requests we have received have specifically been for help paying for a safe place to spend the night. You may make donations during the offering collection. You can mail a check to 57 Reed Street, Tarpon Springs, Florida, 34689, or donate projects just to, or donate online on the church website, uutarpon.org, and select social justice projects. Please note that you are giving to the minister's discretionary fund in the comment. Donations will be accepted all this month. To support this work, please go to our website, uutarpon.org, click on the donate button, select social justice, give the plate, indicate minister's discretionary fund. Thank you. The offering will now be given today.
I have two readings this morning. The first is from The Revolutionary Function of the Modern Church, written by Unitarian minister Reverend John Haynes Holmes. Poverty in this age, as in every age, in our country, as in every country, is primarily due to the fact of social injustice, that employment cannot be had by those who are ready to work, that employment, even when regular, is not paid enough to enable the faithful and efficient workman to guard against illness, to protect his widow from dependence, or to provide for his old age. That insufficient wages force thousands of families to crowd into unhealthy tenements, to eat insufficient food, and to wear insufficient clothing, thus paving the way for physical weakness and disability. That accidents rob the wage earners without compensation from society. That taxes are inequitable, throwing the chief burden upon the poor instead of upon the rich. That natural resources, which are the basis of all wealth, are in the hands of a few instead of under the control of society at large, and are thus exploited for the benefit of the few and not for the sake of the common welfare. The distribution of wealth is grossly unfair and disproportionate. In the final analysis, that society is organized upon a basis of injustice and not of justice, and is permeated by the spirit of selfishness and not of love. Those words, as much as they ring true today, were written in 1912. The second reading is Bread and Roses, which was published by James Oppenheimer in 1910. As we go marching, marching in the beauty of the day, a million darkened kitchens, a thousand mill lofts gray, are touched with all the radiance that a sudden sun discloses. For the people hear us singing, bread and roses, bread and roses. As we go marching, marching, we battle too for men, for they are women's children, and we mother them again. Our lives shall not be sweated from birth until life closes. Hearts starve as well as bodies. Give us bread, but give us roses. As we go marching, marching, unnumbered women dead go crying through our singing their ancient call for bread. Small art and love and beauty their drudging spirits know. Yes, it is bread we fight for, but we fight for roses too. As we go marching, marching, we bring the greater days. The rising of the women means the rising of the race. No more the drudge and idler, ten that toil where one reposes, but a sharing of life's glories, bread and roses, bread and roses. Our lives shall not be sweated from birth until life closes. Hearts starve as well as bodies, bread and roses, bread and roses. As the word pandemic became part of the daily news, workers in service industries were at particularly high risk at their workplaces in ways that previously had not been recognized. Stores, medical centers, office buildings, and distribution centers were among those places deeply impacted. Amazon fulfillment centers made the news for their workers' concerns about their working conditions. This wasn't news, really. Employees had voiced concerns about their treatment by the giant retailer before, and this was further called into question when founder and executive chairman Jeff Bezos rocketed himself into space in July of 2021. But now there was a pandemic, with New York City among the areas hit hardest. Distressed about the working conditions, Christian Smalls and his best friend Derek Palmer organized a small walkout with some other employees at Amazon's only fulfillment center in New York City in March of 2020. Company retaliation was great and fast. Anti-union consultants were brought in, union busting techniques were used, and pressure began to be applied in ample measure. Part of Amazon's response was to fire Smalls for participating in the walkout. This is a common tactic for upsetting possible momentum toward unionizing and what was viewed by the company as disruptive behavior to the flow of business. But it was that act, the firing of Smalls in April of 2020, that has impacted Amazon in ways that it had hoped to avoid. That act convinced Smalls and Palmer to unionize Amazon's employees. They've had no affiliation with a national labor organization, and their efforts, which have included bonfires, posting videos to TikTok, potlucks, and a lot of conversation, are their own and financially supported by a GoFundMe campaign. They started the Amazon Labor Union a year after Small was fired, fighting against a company with what seems an unending supply of money, and the warehouse Smalls had been fired from has now voted to be unionized. Success likely stemmed from different factors, including the homestyle approach taken by Smalls and Palmer, as well as their insider status. It's easier, after all, to connect with people who know you know what they're experiencing and who meet up with you at the same bus stops on the way into work, who live where you live, who look like you look. The tightened labor market has helped, too, and awareness of the working conditions of frontline and other workers has also played a part. This victory for the Amazon Labor Union is changing traditional narratives about how to do things and who gets to lead change. Smalls has been getting more press recently, both as a second Amazon location moves to vote on unionizing and because Smalls doesn't look the traditional part of someone with power. He's often seen in large sunglasses, hoodies, sweatpants, and sneakers, often in his favorite color red, with a do-rag on his head under a baseball cap. As a black man, a millennial, and a worker, his approach to fighting Amazon's labor practices resonates strongly with others in his generational group and other non-dominant groups within U.S. society. And most importantly, while Amazon had run a large smear campaign against Smalls when he was fired, making him the face of what the company didn't want in their employees, Smalls has used his look and outlook to connect with people, which has undoubtedly helped lead others to join the unionizing efforts. Smalls is advocating for workers to be treated like the human beings they are, with compassion, talking about their need for care and support, as well as fair wages, benefits, and safe working conditions. Florida is known for many things: sunshine, oranges, Disney, a terrible governor, retired people, alligators, tourism, and an understanding that some pure ridiculousness is sure to follow in a news report that begins with a Florida man. Unions are very much not on this list, unlike Northeast Ohio, where I am from. There, where manufacturing was once a vibrant sector of the economy, think steel workers and automotive workers, among others, a number of groups were unionized, those in manufacturing, as well as teachers, emergency service providers, government workers, and so on. I won't lie, as a teenager working for Revco and then CVS, I was a bit skeptical of unions. I knew some about the history of unions and their importance in labor history, who doesn't love not having to work more than 40 hours a week, paid holidays, lunch breaks, and so on. But when the rep would come in, dressed in a suit with an unnatural for Northeast Ohio tan, which is to say, any tan at all, skepticism was no surprise. But Florida is where the first teachers' strike in the U.S. took place. Teachers met in Orlando at the Citrus Bowl to rally. Governor Kirk, who had recently been elected in 1968, had promised to make Florida number one in the country in education. Then shortly after taking office, he planned to cut the education budget significantly. Teachers were mad. Their working conditions were bad. Some school buildings were described as crumbling. They didn't have enough books for their classes, let alone up-to-date books, and conditions overall just weren't good. So in February 1968, 35,000 teachers turned in their resignation letters on the same day and went on strike. The strike lasted for 3 weeks. Unfortunately, what was first in the country was also the last for the state. There were no immediate gains for those who went on strike, with some returning to work and others losing their jobs for having taken part in it. It's worth noting that in 1966, 2 years before the strike, the teachers' unions in Florida merged into the FEA, the Florida Education Association. That is, black and white unions merged into this new union, and this strike was seen by many as a way to address the disparities between black and white schools. Teachers easily found common cause together and used that to try to leverage the changes they sought and further advance civil rights. It wasn't until 6 years after that strike, in 1974, that Florida passed a collective bargaining law, which allowed the union to negotiate directly with schools on behalf of the teachers. Through their work, teachers earned paid holidays and employer-backed retirement. But the trade-off was high. Laws were put into place that the teachers couldn't strike. The bar against striking extends to other public employees and is written into both the state constitution and state law. Union membership rates in Florida are low, among the lowest in the country, somewhere between 6 and 6.5% of the population, whereas the national average is close to 11%. However, because Florida is a right-to-work state, unions represent close to 8% of workers in the state. Part of right to work means that employees can opt out of union membership and still benefit from contracts negotiated by unions. While this sounds like the people who aren't members of unions are making out on a good deal, getting benefits without paying for them, the picture is a little messier. After all, those who aren't union members can't be claimed as part of the bargaining collective, and numbers mean something when negotiating wages, benefits, and other aspects of contracts. Not being a union member decreases the union's leverage for bargaining. The larger history in the United States is equally fraught, even as it varies across the economy. The first reported worker strike actually dates back to 1768, when journeyman tailors protested a wage reduction. The first sustained trade union organization in the U.S. was formed in 1794 by shoemakers in Philadelphia. Local craft and trade unions became popular across the country after that. As industrialization spread across the U.S., populations shifted. More workers were needed in large factories, and different trades were suddenly together under one roof. Alliances were quickly formed among different unions, and the presence of multiple unions together, along with increased numbers of workers, made union membership more common. Of course, most of those unions excluded women, black workers, and immigrants. And women, black workers, and immigrants often formed their own unions when they could. After the Civil War, immigration was expanded, flooding the labor market, and employers were able to pit groups against each other to exploit labor for lower wages. Striking happened at times to varying effect. Unions not only organized and advocated for wages and working conditions, but also labor reforms. It was through the efforts of unions that Congress finally created a Department of Labor in 1913. With the Great Depression, unions gained support as places where workers could seek employment and protection. It was in the 1930s that the CIO, the Congress of Industrial Organizations, was formed, which organized large numbers of black workers for the first time. The American Federation of Labor, the AFL, by comparison, was formed in 1886. Those two organizations merged to form the AFL-CIO in 1955 and was a crucial player in helping civil rights legislation get passed in the 1960s. Union membership as a percentage of employment reached its peak here in the U.S. in the 1940s to 1950s. By the late 1950s, union membership started to drop as the economy continued to change and legislation was enacted that prevented some previous striking practices, not to mention that working conditions, wages, and labor practices in general had improved in a number of industries by this time. In the late 1950s, labor organizing moved to lower paid workers, including pharmacists, hospital workers, nursing home workers, and farm workers. Pharmacists really made out there. Unitarian Universalist and Unitarian Universalist thought on unionizing and worker rights are undoubtedly as complicated as general American history is. While I would naturally assume favor on the side of the workers, I know that my teaching congregation in Youngstown, Ohio, was nearly split in two in the 1930s by pro- and anti-union factions, as much of the congregation was of the factory management group before a pro-union minister settled himself there, causing great divisiveness. Similarly, George Pullman of the Pullman Company, Pullman Sleeping Cars, the company Town Pullman, and the Pullman Strike was a Universalist. He had the Pullman Town built for the workers who manufactured the sleeping cars for his company, which led to the Pullman strike in 1894 due to the high rent prices charged for the company housing and a reduction in wages paid by the company. The Pullman company also hired black workers as porters who offered elite service but were only compensated with tips. Proud Universalist moment there. The strike in the spring failed and was followed by a boycott that lasted about 2 months. At its peak, the boycott involved around 250,000 workers in 27 states. Rioting broke out in the Chicago area, and President Grover Cleveland sent troops there, and rioting then spread out in other cities as well. The federal government became involved in the strike because of the disruption in railroad service that impacted mail delivery. These events revealed to Americans that all was not well, as company owners and managers would have had them believe. Workers were not being cared for or treated fairly by those they worked for. One of the greatest takeaways from these events was this change in social understanding, as the wider public became aware of disparities and began to pay attention and seek solutions. On the other hand of our consideration of Unitarians, Universalists, and Unitarian Universalists, William Ellery Channing was among the more outspoken advocates of working men's associations, forebears of our modern day unions. Theodore Parker was also an advocate for workers, and both ministers spoke out against the exploitation of people. However, I'm not sharing any excerpts of their work because they were painful to read from my 2022 perspective. In the same vein, Brook Farm had been formed in 1841. It was an experiment in communal living founded by Unitarian minister George Ripley and his wife Sophia. Their goal was to create what has since been described as a utopian society, where labor and leisure were balanced while working together for the greater community. Their labor was chosen based on their interests, and all were paid equally, even the women. These efforts and advocating are well over 150 years old in some cases, and still people struggle. I won't make the claim that unions are the best and always answer, but they wouldn't be needed if employers actually cared for their employees like the human beings they are, and not as a liability to their bottom line. Even companies often considered decent or even great to work for, like Starbucks and Apple, have workers organizing right now to unionize, with Starbucks workers already having big victories. And there are definitely groups that aren't unions that are making significant progress in their respective industries for workers' rights and working conditions. The Coalition of Immokalee Workers, who have been supported by our Give the Plates in the past, are one such group, as is the Independent Drivers Guild, a coalition of gig workers for Uber and Lyft, Restaurant Opportunity Centers United, which advocates for food service workers, and others. Today is Mayday, or International Workers' Day, and many countries celebrate today as their Labor Day. U.S. American Labor Day is, of course, in September, but at a time when workers' rights movements are gaining momentum across this country, this is a time to recognize their efforts and celebrate. Suffragist and workers' rights advocate Helen McGregor Todd helped popularize the phrase bread and roses starting in around 1911. Bread and Roses was captured in the poem I read earlier in late 1910 and became a rallying cry for striking workers in early 1912 as textile workers across the city of Lawrence, Massachusetts protested wage reductions, hour reductions, and working conditions. They sought to make one facet of the human condition. They sought to make work one facet of the human condition, and to remind all that dignity, appreciation, and beauty are all essential to making work and living just. And so this month, as we begin reflecting on the theme of nurturing beauty, may we all be reminded that beauty isn't just about paintings and flowers, but also about having a good, meaningful life we can delight in. In the hubbub of our daily living, of what we experience in the world around us, the routines and schedules we are meant to follow, we can all sometimes forget we only have one life to live. Our time is precious. Our connections with each other are more important than how many widgets we can assemble, pack in a box, or direct others to fabricate. Life is abundant with truth, beauty, wisdom, and wonder, and we all need to know these things to our bones to have our best lives. If you would please join me in singing our closing hymn, number 109, as we come marching, marching.
As we come marching, marching.
Close with words from Jean Harrison Nuyar, who has written in The Gift of Faith. In the lore of ancient China, there's a story of a philosopher who was asked, "Where is the road called hope?" He replied, "It does not exist, but as people move forward upon it, it comes into being." I invite you to continue moving forward on this ever-widening, ever-increasingly just and equitable road, if we make it so, called hope with me.
This old French melody, I will sing in French, but Joli mois de mai is the lovely month of May, and it's all about pledging one's love to one another and how beautiful that is in the month of May.
Je ne le saurais.
We hope that you found meaning in today's service. We close with these words from Maggie Lovins. We extinguish this flame, but not its meaning and mission in our hearts. Our time together has come to an end. Go in peace, be of service to one another, and may you move through the world in love for all of your days. I do have some announcements today. Please join us at about 12 o'clock after you've had a chance to get a cup of coffee and a snack. We're going to meet on the church patio to have a talk with each other about our ideas moving forward with joys and concerns on Sundays. This is a great opportunity for all to share ideas. Zoom people will also have the opportunity to talk with Alex during their conversation time after the service. The Shaka Caribbean restaurant that was going to host us today for the Ukraine benefit was canceled for today, but will be rescheduled. Social justice people will let us know when that happens. Next Sunday, May 8th, we'll be doing our flower service. We ask that you bring flowers that will be passed to everyone to share. Reverend Kristina and our membership chair, Judy Lucarelli, will be hosting another new to UUCTS meeting after the church in the forum room and over Zoom on May 8th. On May 15th, there will be a Buddha birthday brunch in the social hall. Check the sign up sheet for vegetarian dishes that you can bring and its details. It's also very important to keep checking the newsletter connections online weekly. They've done a beautiful job organizing everything and putting it in order so that you can read long parts, new parts. You'll love it if you go there, and it'll keep you updated on everything that we're doing. And today, for the first time, we would like to invite you to stay with us for just a couple minutes. They're going to use the TV screen for the Zoom people so they can see us and for us to have a chance to say hello to everyone on Zoom. Thank you again for joining us, and we hope to meet you in the social hall and the patio. Thank you for coming.